Hello everyone, I'm a retired Olympic fencer who no longer has any interaction with the sport besides continuing to be in touch with the people I used to know from my competition days.
Though I'm no longer an active fencer, many of my friends are. So I continue to follow the sport by watching live streams and following results online. And what I have seen recently has left me upset and concerned. There seems to be a lot of controversy surrounding a few athletes and teams, and a few referees always seem to be involved. Nearly all of the top fencers and high-level coaches I have spoken to are aware of this problem, but nobody is really sure what to do about it. Everyone is terrified to speak up for fear of repercussions either against themselves or against their athletes. The more subjectivity there is in a sport, the easier it is for this kind of controversy to infiltrate said sport. One only must Google sports scandals to see a long list of scandals that have marred sports where judges have a large impact on the outcome. Back when World Cups were held in dimly lit, slippery gymnasiums with no cameras, comically biased decisions and sketchy situations were so common that it used to be treated as a joke. One of the biggest positives of the advent of video refereeing and streaming was that referees had to be much more careful about the calls that they make because each of their decisions would be publicly available on camera. There are currently several issues associated with this scandal in the sport. Before I discuss them in more detail, let me give you a quick breakdown of how referees are assigned at FIE events. There is a more technical explanation, but the simple version of Rule T.50 in the FIE technical rulebook, link in video description, is that referees are assigned to poles and direct elimination fights randomly. Referees cannot be assigned to any pole or a quarter of the direct elimination tableau that includes a fencer of their nationality. In addition, from the semi-finals onwards, no referee can be the same nationality as any fencer in the top four. In the event of a mistake by the computer, referees may be reassigned and notes must be kept on who has been reassigned. However, this information is never released, and so it is impossible to tell if this rule is upheld. Conflicts must be declared beforehand, but as I will demonstrate later, this is definitely not always the case. A very important player in this game is Vasyl Malyshev, a Bulgarian referee who has been considered the best saber referee in the world for a long time. He is involved in many incidents that will be outlined in this video, and the Bulgarians are often given quite a lot of help from the referees. The most well-known example of Bulgarians receiving support from referees was during the 2016 Olympic qualification event for the European zone. The top four fencers at the competition qualified for the Olympics, and the Bulgarian fencer, Pancho Paskov, had only one fencer standing in his way of Olympic qualification, British fencer James Honeybone. Marius Floria, who is a close friend of Malyshev and considered one of the top referees in the world, refereed this important fight, and it seemed like every single two light hit went to the Bulgarian, who eventually ended up winning the fight and qualifying for the Olympics. According to my friends who are still active on the circuit, when Malyshev is not refereeing, he will often observe fights during Bulgarian fences from a position where he can be easily seen by the referee. While this behavior isn't illegal, it is perceived by other coaches as a form of intimidation. For this reason, with the exception of the Paskov incident, we can call what happens with Bulgarian fencers more of a strong bias than any foul play. and this is the least egregious of the potential issues. But I remember Vesel Milinshev's name because he will come up again many times in this video. Our story for the next fencer on the list begins during the later qualification stages for the 2020 Olympics. Around this time, Italian FIE referee Marco Siesto retired from international refereeing and began coaching a fencer in Kuwait named Youssef El Shamlan, whose family had a tremendous amount of money and whose father is head of the Kuwaiti Fencing Federation. It quickly became clear that Siesto was using his connections to place refs on Al Shamlan's fight, who could help him accumulate the points he would need to qualify for the 2020 Olympics. It was easy to award him hits because his style is apparently designed to enable this kind of refereeing support, making the longest, fastest step forward lunge possible and get your light on. At the final qualification event in Budapest, it was a tight race between Yoshida Kanto and Youssef El Shamlan. After the preliminary elimination round of the final Olympic qualification event, Yoshida had been eliminated in the last 96, receiving one FIE point, granting him a total of 34.5. With exactly 30 points, El Shamlan would need to reach the last 16 to accumulate enough points to qualify for Olympics. After winning a dubious fight against Amr from Egypt in the last 64, you can kind of hear part of the conversation between El Shamlan's coach and the referee of the next fight. You cannot make out everything that he said, but you can hear him saying something along the lines of, "It is impossible for Anstead to qualify because Epithy is ahead of him." The fight is an absolute mess, with Al Shamlan being awarded many hits he does not deserve. Some of my friends even say that Anstead was bribed into throwing this fight. If this is actually true, Anstead clearly did not accept bribes as he ultimately won.
Alex.
After the fight was over, Margo Siesto, who is well known to have no filter, was happy to tell anyone who would listen about how unhappy he was at Al Shamlan lost, because he would have the potential bonus of hundreds of thousands of dollars if someone he coached qualified for the Olympic this year. This treatment of Al Shamlan continues through to present day, and is probably the worst case of referee bias that is happening right now. Nearly every referee who is assigned to him provide significant amounts of support and protection. At a satellite World Cup this year in Kuwait, Al Shamlan was basically handled all of his victories, with his Bulgarian opponent and Italian opponent in the semi-final and final respectively, putting up no fight at all.
Thank you.
If all of that wasn't enough, Al Shamlan himself frequently stops the hits for no reason, or go off piss after missing on purpose so that the ref will call halt. He is almost never punished for these shenanigans. Here are more examples of sketchiness occurring during the fight. Let's talk about Mitchell Sauron next. During his junior career, he was ranked as high as number one in the world in his age category. As a very dynamic, flamboyant fencer who tries lots of ambitious blade actions and bouncing attacks, he has always been extremely entertaining to watch. Going into this Budapest Senior FIE event in 2022, according to Mitchell's FIE profile, he had competed at 14 senior FIE events since his first one in 2016, and had achieved one last 64 and one last 32. Here are all the poll results from the 2022-2023 season leading up to Budapest, the competition before Olympic qualification begins. You can see here that Mitchell wasn't exactly a strong pole fencer, and that led to tougher matchups in the earlier rounds, usually leading to his early elimination. But if a fencer is ranked in the top 16 following the pole stages, they can progress straight to the round of 64. Here are his results from Budapest onwards. Budapest, Seoul, Madrid, Milan. Suddenly, Mitchell seemed like one of the top fencers in the world, achieving three last 16s and a last 32 in a row. And every time he performed well except this last 32 fight, Milenshev was present, refereeing nearly all of his fights. The difference in pole results is especially striking. When Milenshev is refereeing, he barely gets hit at all, with other refs not nearly as good. Plus 25, plus 27, and plus 24, with Milenshev refereeing him. At the time of making this video, Saren had never lost a pole fight with Milenshev reffing him, and his average indicator is plus 25.33. Without Milenshev, his average number of pole victories is 3.5, and his average indicator is 1.83. Pole streaming effectively doesn't exist, so it isn't easy to get footage from these early rounds. But when Milenshev refs Mitchell in an elimination round, there are always some, shall we say, creative calls in Mitchell's favor. Currently, Saren is in first place in the US rankings with so many points that it seems very unlikely that four people will surpass him and knock him out of the team selections for the Olympics.
Контратак сур ла блейд. Реприз атак, реприз контратак. Реприз атак, туш по.
Thank you.
The primary question we want to answer is if a fencer in question, Mitchell Saron, is encountering the same referee more frequently than other fencers. This means we have to find a way to compare his referees against his competitors. One might first think to compare the number of unique referees Mitchell has at a tournament against the other fencers, but quickly two main problems arise. One, there is no standard amount of rounds a fencer will compete in. Fencer A may lose after the pools, while fencer B may make it to the medal rounds. In this case, fencer A would have only encountered one unique referee, while fencer B may have encountered up to 8 unique referees. 2. A single tournament isn't a great sample size. There are bound to be multiple fencers in a single tournament who, just due to chance, will have the same referee multiple times. After all, an average World Cup has about 230 fencers and only about 20 referees. In order to make a meaningful comparison, we have to find a way to address both problems. The first problem can be solved by slightly altering what we compare. Instead of comparing the objective number of unique referees a fencer encounters, we can instead create a ratio of the number of unique referees that fencer encountered divided by the number of rounds that he fenced. This way, it doesn't matter if the fencer fenced a single round or 8, the ratio will always be between 0 and 1. A value of 1 means that the fencer encountered a unique referee in every bout he fenced, while a value close to 0 would mean that the fencer essentially encountered the same referee all day. Using the example from earlier, fencer A fenced only the pool round with one unique referee. Thus, his ref ratio would be 1 divided by 1, for a ratio of 1. Fencer B, who fenced 8 rounds with 8 unique referees, would be 8 divided by 8, also a ratio of 1. Despite fencers A and B fencing a different number of rounds, we are still able to compare their ratios. The second problem is an easier problem to solve. We can simply expand the scope of our investigation beyond just a single tournament. Say, all tournaments since the beginning of Olympic qualification, Budapest 2023. With multiple tournaments, we can see if a trend begins to emerge, rather than taking guesses at whether or not the happenings of a single tournament were due to chance. Now that we have set up our foundation, we can actually begin to look at the numbers. First, we should establish a baseline of what a normal ref ratio should look like. For this, I looked at the three fencers above and below Mitchell in the FIE rankings and calculated an average ref ratio. These fencers are Krzysztof Kaczkowski, Poland, Andrew Dado, USA, Hansel Ha, Korea, Enver Ildrim, Turkey, Pietro Torre, Italy, and Colin Heathcock, USA. Their average ratio comes out to 0.9118, very close to 1. This indicates that on average, these fencers very rarely encounter the same referee twice in the same tournament. Now, let's look at Mitchell's ratio across the same six tournaments. On this graph, the red line indicates the average ratio of 0.9118, and the black line indicates his average ref ratio. Each dot on the graph represents an individual tournament. His average ref ratio comes out to 0.65, about 30% less than the average. This is due to the fact that he has 4 tournaments where his ref ratio is 0.5 or lower. But this is just a comparison of Mitchell against his closest ranked peers. How does he compare against other random fencers? I randomly selected 3 other fencers that also competed in the same 6 tournaments and calculated their ref ratios too. Mao Kakubo, Japan, Andriy Yagodka, Ukraine, and Sebastian Patrice, France. Have added a red line indicating the average ratio of 0.9118 and the average ref ratio of each fencer. We can see from this graph that Kakubo and Yagodka have only a single tournament with a referee ratio of 0.5, and Patrice's lowest ratio is 0.6. The vast majority of tournaments these fencers have a ratio of 0.8 or higher, with their averages much closer to 0.9118. I understand that there are limitations with this analysis, and I'm happy to respond to any critics. However, I think the ultimate conclusion to draw from these data is that Mitchell Saron is encountering the same referee much more frequently than his peers, both those that are similarly and dissimilarly ranked. The next important name to note is Neslimov. Vladimir Neslimov was an Olympic fencer for the Soviet Union. He was a very strong fencer who has 6 Olympic medals to his name. He is currently the head coach of the Uzbekistan Sabre program, where he moved after he retired from Ohio State University in 2018 in lieu of termination for NCAA rule violations. His son, Vitaly, is an owner of Neslimov Fencing, a club in Maryland. Their daughter, Tatiana, is a current member of the U.S. women's saber team. In the USA, the refereeing environment does not tolerate gamesmanship or conflicts of interest. Allegations of this type are apparently taken extremely seriously in the U.S. An FIE referee from Azerbaijan moved to the U.S. around 2018 and began working for Neslimov Fencing. It was naturally assumed that such a highly rated FIE referee would be someone who would take a leading role in USA referee development and mentoring, especially at American ranking competitions. But there were so many complaints of unfair refereeing made against Fikret Valiyev in his first season of refereeing that he was no longer hired to referee at these competitions. When he coaches at these competitions, he puts so much pressure on referees that many referees with less confidence or experience are pressured into giving hits that are underserved to fencers at Neslimov's club. Valiyev is also one of the key players internationally, but we will get back to him later. Neslimov's results are particularly odd because, even though she is currently fourth in the US points, during this Olympic season she has accumulated 0 points from American competitions. In order to get points at these tournaments, she would have to finish in the last 32, and her results so far at American competitions this season are 36th and 39th for an average placement of 37.5. Her World Cup results, however, are 21st, 91st, 7th, 22nd, and 41st for an average placement of 36.4. It seems very strange that Tatiana is unable to perform well in national competitions, the significantly easier category, but performs very well internationally. But it seems like she is receiving quite a lot of help in these matches. Earlier this year, she won a fight against Imura Misaki, where there were several dubious decisions all awarded in one direction. One of my friends was able to film her pole fights in one of her recent competitions in Orleans, and this doesn't look particularly good either, especially since the referee is frequently awarding hits to Neslimov that he is happy to give the other way when she makes the same mistake.
Thank you.
Attack, stop, attack. Attack, stop, stop, attack, stop. No more video. Agar.
Many of you may have already heard of another interesting situation from Orleans, courtesy of fencing highlighter Slicer Saber. Remember Fykrat Valiev, the FIE referee who currently coaches at Neslimov Fencing? While another person listed on the website of Neslimov Fencing is Vladimir Neslimov, the current coach of the Uzbek team. In Slicer Saber's post, he showed that Valiev, while refereeing a fight with an Uzbek fencer in it, made a few comically bad decisions in favor of the Uzbek fencer. It is a clear conflict of interest to be refereeing someone who is coached by one of your co-workers. Yet, this is not an isolated incident. Every Uzbek fencer seems to receive quite a lot of help from the referees, that Fykrat referees them frequently. The fight between Mamutov and Lo in the finals of the Asian Zonal Qualification Competition from the last Olympic cycle, refereed by Milinshev, was particularly egregious. It seems like every simultaneous action in this fight was always given in one direction. This support provided to the Uzbeks isn't even localized to Saber. When I was chatting to a foil fencer, she alerted to me the fact that a similar situation occurred in the final of women's foil at the same competition between a Singaporean and an Uzbek fencer. The Uzbek was given several right-of-way hits when she was clearly attempting to counterattack. The fact that Berthier won this fight is a minor miracle. I wouldn't go into the foil aspect too much because I do not know nearly as much about the right-of-way in foil as I do in Saber.
Oh!
The major issue with saber fencing arises from the subjectivity of referee decisions. Any decision made in isolation can be justified in any direction for a variety of reasons. When you see all of these come together, it starts to form a pattern that is difficult to ignore. The pattern I see here is that when these fencers are on pist, consistency seems to be ignored, and only one fencer seems to get the benefit of these odd decisions. These people are smart. They don't give every ambiguous decision in one direction, but they flip just enough in key moments to have a major impact on the fight. It is most commonly decisions in the middle 4 meters of the pist that are flipped, most often not giving preparation against the fencer who is being helped. The huge effect that this has is that it becomes extremely difficult to parry someone or make them miss when the referee is not calling preparation, because the person had no fear of watching and waiting for just a bit longer. This encourages this kind of fencer to make very fast attacks with their footwork in the middle 4 meters, but they hold a bit of with their arms. If we look at Neslimov, Saron, Alshamlan, and many of the Uzbek fencers, they all fence this way. With all things being equal, making an Olympic team takes more out of you than you can possibly imagine. But because things are not perceived to be equal here, many of my friends are wondering what the point is of even continuing to fence. This is a very serious issue that goes far beyond only the people who may be involved. So what can we do? Vesel Milinchev, Fykrat Veliyev, and Marius Floria are some of the highest rated referees in the FIE, and are some of the people with the most power. It seems astronomically unlikely that the FIE doesn't know about this, but if they do know about this, what can they really do? I have not been able to confirm with any evidence that any of this is actually happening. Indeed, it could simply be a series of coincidences that all of these horrible decisions are going in one direction, and that there isn't any actual foul play or duplicitous behavior at all. But even if that is the case, shouldn't we still be very concerned by the fact that our supposed top referees are making these many terrible mistakes? With no smoking gun, the best thing we can do is to talk about the issue. The more the better. I was already aware that this is happening, but Slicer Saber inspired me to really do a deep dive with his video, Cool Saber Touches, and I found much more than I was expected to. I used the clips in his video as a starting point to look for the clips I used in this video. For the reasons mentioned above, my friend, who has nothing to do with fencing, and I have chosen to remain anonymous. I would like to thank her tremendously for lending me her voice, helping me write the script, and for actually doing the editing on this video. Since she speaks English and edits videos better than I can, someone out there knows something and can prove something. If you do and you're willing to speak up, please email me at ponsdeleonfencing@gmail.com.